But we're at a Labour club on Merseyside, and with us we have trade unionists, workers, employers and MPs. Now, the situation here tonight in Liverpool is that Leyland's Triumph plant is still at a standstill. For one reason or another, not a single TR7 has been produced there since August. Liverpool docks are at a standstill, 5,000 men are on strike there. Bird's Eye have been stopped for 2 months because of a strike and are threatening to shelve expansion plans. And now it seems that the Ford car plant at Hale Wood is threatened with a strike, and in fact both sides are meeting there tonight. Well, let's find out what's behind some of those disputes. Now, in the audience, we have shop stewards both from the docks and from the Triumph plant at Speak. Let's go first of all to you, Dave Thomas. What is it that's behind the strike at Speak?
Well, there's a very simple reason, John, for the dispute at Speak. And that is that whilst we have a plant agreement, the company refuse, or when I say refuse, ignore, to operate the plant agreement.
The agreement's on what?
Well, there is an agreement on the way in which we would establish manning levels and efficiency levels and etc. as a result. Now, we take a simple view in Liverpool, you know, and it's not unique to us, but it may well be considered to be unique to other people. In the absence of an agreement, or something that replaces an agreement, then there is no operation.
Unfortunately, we haven't got Leyland management here. We did invite them, but they felt unable to come, so we have to take your word for it that they've broken the agreement. They may take a different view, I don't know. But in fact, it does seem, perhaps to people outside, almost a trivial issue on which to keep the plant stopped for so long, and we read even to jeopardise its future that Leyland are now considering pulling out.
Well, I think the answer to your question, really, that you're seeking is the question of its future. But I would take the view that the important part of the question is whether it's trivial or not to go and dispute over an agreement. Now, we have an agreement at Liverpool in the Triumph plant that is signed by both parties, and obviously both parties are accountable to that agreement in effect. And we as trade unions in the Liverpool plant have continuously, much to the discontent on occasion of our membership, said that you are a party to an agreement, because an agreement made is an agreement kept in our view. Whether it's a bad, indifferent or whatever agreement, an agreement made is an agreement kept.
Dennis Kelly, what's behind the strike on the docks? What's the problem there?
Well, it's only what we'd call a storm in a teacup. We've had 4 years of peace, good labour relations, and now just we'll probably be settled in the morning, we hope.
What's the particular storm in a teacup, as you call it, over then?
Well, it was the clash of personalities. One of the managers, a row with the lads, told them they'd get no holiday pay, they'd get no pay, and I'll see that you don't get a sub. Well, you get the occasional clown everywhere.
You represent the customers who use Liverpool docks. Will they regard it as a storm in a teacup?
No, we regard it as very serious, because if there's a stoppage in the port, it's the first stoppage, as Dennis has said, for 4 years. It's very serious because it can result in lost business. That's why we're very, very concerned.
So what's your feeling about the situation now?
Well, my feeling is that I think that management and the men should get this settled as quickly as possible. And if Dennis says they can get it settled tomorrow, I'm very, very pleased to hear this, and I hope that they do.
Eric Heffer, MP for Walton, former industry minister, what's your feeling about what we've heard and about the situation in Liverpool at the moment? Is there something specially difficult about industrial relations in Liverpool?
No, I don't think there's anything especially difficult, but I think managements on Merseyside, particularly when they come in from outside, have to recognise that the Merseyside worker is a worker who believes in solidarity, who believes in trade union principles, and is not willing to be pushed and forced into anything. He must, in fact, be convinced that it's right what he's doing.
Is he different from workers elsewhere in that respect?
Well, I don't know all the workers elsewhere. I've worked on Merseyside ever since I was a young fellow, and all I'm telling you is that as far as Merseyside workers are concerned, they want a square deal. They've always wanted a square deal, and I can give you examples of companies in this city who've never had a strike at any time in their lives. I can give you examples of other companies who've had many, many disputes. Now, there must be a point there. And the point is, it's a question of whether one management is prepared to try and force workers to do things and another that's prepared to negotiate and reach proper agreements with workers. Now, what I'm saying is that I would like to see no strikes on Merseyside, of course. That would be an ideal situation. I would like to see a position where we didn't have any problems industrially at all. But we have got problems, but they're no worse than they are in other parts of the country. I could give you an example. Many years ago, or a number of years ago, a factory in my constituency, Lucas's, was closed down. I went with other members of Parliament to see the Lucas management, top management in London. I was told it's because of all the strikes that took place in that factory. We got the figures out. And we discovered that, in fact, the number of strikes in the Birmingham Lucas factories were much higher, much more prolonged, much deeper than any of the disputes had ever been in the Lucas factory on Merseyside. And sometimes, unfortunately, some managements, do use this as an excuse. Our problem, of course, is that we have a declining industry, or many declining industries, and we haven't yet come to terms, although great efforts have been made in creating new industries to replace them.
That's a point we want to come to in a few minutes. Now, Eddie Loyden, the Speak Factory, the Triumph Speak Factory, is in your constituency. What if Leyland carry out this threat that apparently they are considering pulling out of Speak?
Well, as far as we're concerned, it will be opposed with the full resistance of, as far as I'm concerned, not only from Parliament, but from the whole of the trade union and labour movement in this area. Because we believe that we've got to recognise that there are problems in Leyland's, but we believe, in fact, that the way of tackling them is not to axe a part of Leyland's that lies in an area of high unemployment. And this can't be disregarded as a major Merseyside problem.
Even if Leyland feel it's not an efficient enough plant?
Well, those sort of judgments have not been made in this case. I mean, the point has been made that the comparisons being made by Leyland's have certainly not been confirmed insofar as management is concerned. Well, and there again, many of the disputes in Leyland's have been caused by forces outside of the power of the Leyland worker, particularly on the question of the component side. In that sense, is in many cases unfair to Leyland workers.
Well, can I go back to the shop stewards now from Speak? Now, what is your reaction when you hear things like the suggestion that Leyland pull out? What effect does that have on your attitude?
Well, if I could speak on behalf of the shop stewards, we all understand and appreciate the circumstances that currently affect Leyland cars. We all understand that to be competitive, we have to have a measure of improvement in efficiency levels and productivity levels. And we are quite prepared to go forward with the company in order to achieve them improvements. Let's make no mistake about that. Because we believe, contrary to common belief, certainly since we have government finance through the NEB, that we are in part accountable for the activity in any Leyland plant. But we also believe that any improvements in productivity and efficiency must come through consultation and negotiation. Because it is a simple belief on our part. We don't believe in giving paper commitments. We would rather give a firm commitment and say we are prepared to do that by agreement. And if, for instance, the company or the membership don't agree, then it's by agreement, like it or lump it.
Right.
Now, having said that, on this occasion, the company have chose to act in an untoward fashion with regard to the trade unions on Liverpool. In respect
and
of
your
the
attitude
plants.
Is if they're not prepared to observe the agreement, which in your view they've broken,
let me say
then you
this.
Can't go back.
Let me say this. As a result of a dubious report in the Sunday Telegraph of this week, it was suggested possibly that the Speak plant could close.
You say dubious, you don't think it will happen?
And as a result of that also, the transfer of TR7 production and dolomite production to other Leyland plants. Now, we would resist, and I say resist, in any way, shape or form, the transfer of production from Liverpool to any other plant.
Right, we've got to interrupt you there. I have to interrupt you there because we've got to take a break at that point. Join us again in a couple of minutes.